reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal. May it please the court, my name is David Morey on behalf of the National Labor Relations Board. The issue here is whether the district court properly invoked LEADM jurisdiction to vacate a decision issued by the board pursuant to Section 10K of the National Labor Relations Act. That decision sought to resolve a jurisdictional dispute between two unions, the Longshoremen's Union and the Electricians Union, over certain work at Terminal 6 of the Port of Portland. Your Honors, a LEADM jurisdiction is supposed to be exercised only in extraordinary circumstances. In justifying exercising of jurisdiction in our case, the district court found that PMA did not have an adequate means of obtaining judicial review of the 10K decision for itself. We find this portion of the district court's ruling problematic when one considers the fact that PMA has stood on the sidelines and has refused to intervene in the appropriate administrative proceeding in which to challenge the board's 10K decision.
Too much account. I mean, PMA's involvement here is somewhat peripheral in the sense that it is neither the employer in question nor the union in question nor the employees in question, right? Its interest is in enforcing its collective bargaining agreement because its own member isn't doing that, right?
Correct.
That's what it's saying. Well, but the ILWU is in the case and has taken the very position that PMA is maintaining, i.e., that there is no jurisdiction here because one of the groups of employees is a public employee, right?
That is the argument that PMA is making.
And it's also been made by the ILWU in the 10K.
It has also been. The ILWU, I think, is focusing. So the ILWU's argument in the 10K proceeding and in the unfair labor practice proceeding that was underway at the time the 10K decision issued focuses on the status of the Port of Portland as being a public entity.
Correct, and that's the argument that's being made here.
But by extension, though, PMA's focus is on the employees as public employees.
Well, my understanding from the 10K opinion, which reported the argument and then answered it, to my mind, not very satisfactorily, was that it was the same argument. There was no jurisdiction because these were public employees.
Well, Your Honor, the board
explained. That's what I was saying is, aside from everything else about the PMA's involvement here, if the ILWU has exactly the same interests, which in this instance, not in general, but in this instance, and is making essentially the same argument, is that something we should take into account?
Well, I think the reason we're here, Your Honor, is because we want to ensure that persons who are not satisfied with board decisions don't go immediately to the district court for a remedy when there are available administrative remedies. It's essentially to protect this process of exhausting your administrative remedies. So the board explained in its decision why it was exercising jurisdiction. Now, even if we were to assume that the board may have made a mistake, there were still, in terms of exercising jurisdiction to resolve the dispute between the two unions, there were still avenues available administratively to cure those mistakes. And that is one of the purposes behind.
Let me ask you a question. Is there any chance that the board didn't make a mistake? I do not understand any argument that's been made to the contrary. In other words, it seems that, to me, close to 100% clear that the board does not have jurisdiction. I understand that you have a whole other reason we shouldn't be doing this, but why is everybody spinning wheels here? If they can't do it, they can't do it.
Your Honor, we believe that this case turns, though, on the availability.
I know that's what you believe, but it's not what I'm asking you. I'm asking you if you have any argument as to why they're not right on the merits, because it's a two-pronged test under legal. The first part is whether it's absolutely clear that there is a jurisdiction, isn't it?
Well, the two-part test is whether there has been a violation of a statutory mandate or a violation of an express statutory command. And then the second part of that test is whether or not.
No, then. I'm asking you about the first part. Do you not want to answer it?
can only work with what the board decision says, and the board explained in the 10-K decision why it was exercising its basis for exercising jurisdiction. Now, as we explained in our brief, why we think that.
What is the basis for exercising jurisdiction? What did they say?
They said that the board said in its 10-K decision that it need only have jurisdiction over any employer who is the target of the unlawful conduct.
Employer, but the subject matter is when there is a dispute between two groups of employees, and one of these groups is not a group of employees because they're public employees.
That is correct, Your Honor. However, we still have the issue, though, of the second lead-em prong, because
let me ask you something. If we were to write an opinion, and we were to say, go through the two prongs, and we go to the first prong, and we say, it's absolutely clear there's no jurisdiction. Then we go to the second prong, and we say, oh, but they could raise it later. So then what happens? Then it becomes a pointless exercise, because now go back to the board, and the board has a Ninth Circuit opinion saying that it's absolutely clear there's no jurisdiction. Is that what we should do?
Again, Your Honor, we are here to ensure that parties simply cannot go to the district court for a remedy when there are available administrative remedies.
So go ahead, Judge Watson.
No, Judge Fisher, go ahead.
I'll flash it, guess that. Okay. Are you saying that it would, in order to preserve the sanctity of Leadham second step, that they should go through the process of either intervening or should have intervened in the unfair labor practice proceeding, or in any event, attempted to take an administrative appeal or an appeal under 10F as an aggrieved party, an aggrieved entity who was not a party, and that's their avenue of seeking relief. And if they did that, then who would decide the question that Judge Berzon put forward, which is whether the board has jurisdiction at all? Who would do that?
Sorry.
Well, you're saying they have an avenue of getting review.
Yes.
The question is, do they have an avenue of ever getting review of whether you have jurisdiction to begin with? If we agree with your argument that they have a 10F, for example, appeal, does that part of that appeal then raise the question of whether the board has jurisdiction at all?
I'm not sure I can answer that question.
The answer must be yes, or else you couldn't be standing up here.
I mean, well, there are two.
You don't seem to have a lot of answers here.
The avenues are, of course, through 10F and through the board's rules and regulations, which would permit PMA.
That's not my question, counsel. I'm just wondering which forum gets to confront the underlying the board's underlying jurisdictional question. Whether we do it or. Are you saying nobody gets to decide that it's all up to the board?
No. I mean, the district court has decided that jurisdictional requirement, and we disagree with what the district court, how the district court ruled.
But you won't tell me why.
Because, again, the elements of Leadham were not met here, Your Honor.
That's Leadham. Okay.
You understand that Leadham is an intervention before a final administrative remedy, as you say, has been exhausted. That's what it's talking about.
Well, yes. I mean.
Okay, and you're saying you win, even if you lose on first prong, you win on second prong. And I'm still asking, who gets to address the underlying first prong question, which is basic jurisdictional to begin with.
The district court and the appellate court gets to address that.
I assume your answer has to be, really not listening to the questions, that the board in the 8B4G proceeding can revisit what is said in the 10K about this question.
They can do that. That is correct.
And if it doesn't revisit it, then there will be a final determination on the question, and there will be a 10F petition available to go back to the court, and then we can decide it. But we can also decide it now, couldn't we?
Yes, you can decide now.
But we decided now. This is what I want to ask you. If we decided now, as a first prong of a two-prong test, then what does the board do with what we decide? Do they ignore us or do they listen to us?
Well, Your Honor, I think one of the problems here is that we do have the issue of no canning. And so,
I'm sorry,
we do have the issue of no canning here, so that that if this court, let's say this court makes a decision, and let's say that this court finds that the district court did not have jurisdiction, then it goes back to the board. We'd ask that it go back to the board so that, because the bottom line is we have a procedurally defective board order. And we can't get away, we can't get around that, Your Honor. So
board order being the 10K.
The 10K decision, correct. So then it gets, so there's a possibility that the board will revisit.
There's a problem too, quite possibly.
I'm sorry, what?
Which does or doesn't have a null canning problem. Which does or does not have a null canning problem.
The 10K has a null canning problem.
Okay. So the board is going to have to redo that anyway.
And the board, I can speak to process, but then the board will, consistent with its practices, revisit the decision and will likely reissue a new decision. I don't know what that decision would be, however.
The board is going to be issuing its decision on a new 10K, is that what you're saying?
It's possible, but I mean, the process
has been. Is that pending? Is that, do we have to do something first? Is that in the works?
No, that would only happen, for example, if this court found, for example, that the district court did not have jurisdiction, and we would ask that, then we have what's left is a defective board order. So that's how the case would be brought back to the board, the 10K decision.
What are you proposing that if we were to agree with your position on jurisdiction, that the district court did not have jurisdiction to do anything here, what are you suggesting our court do with respect to the null canning problem? Do we just say nothing about it? Do we actually issue a ruling that says, I don't know, in light of your concession, the board wasn't properly constituted at the time the 10K order was issued, and so therefore it's vacated? What would we do?
Well, I think if this court finds that the district court did not have jurisdiction, then the null canning issue, null canning matter, was also not properly before the district court. So I don't know if
this. And our position is that you have to still have to meet the Leadham versus Kine standards for null canning purposes, too.
Correct. You have to overcome Leadham versus Kine before you get to the null canning issue. So, Your Honor, as I mentioned, there are two avenues of review, and that is through the unfair labor practice proceeding that was literally in progress at the time the board's 10K decision issued. And that is the proceeding that PMA should have sought to intervene in. There is also the other avenue, which is, I've mentioned before, through Section 1.14 of the board's rules and regulations, in which PMA, as an aggrieved person, can seek review of a final board order. If there is no other further questions, thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. I am Charles Cohen on behalf of Pacific Maritime Association. this case involves the NLRB having made a rare statutory mistake, and instead of rectifying it, doubling down and compounding the mistake. Quite simply, the board has inserted itself as a referee in a dispute between public sector
and private sector. There's pretty good evidence that we understand that, having just listened to the argument. So why don't you just go to the core of the case, okay?
Sure. In terms of the review, we believe that this is indeed a very rare LEADM case. This is not a case which arises from time to time, where typically employers are trying to throw a monkey wrench into a representation case system. This has none of the hallmarks of that. This is a situation where, as we said, the board made a mistake, did not want to admit to it, and we had and have no other means of review within the meaning of LEADM v. Cush.
To this case, this is fairly peripheral.
If I might, with all due respect, Your Honor, it is not peripheral. It is hugely important.
Your basic problem is that your own members comply with its own collective bargaining.
Absolutely. But they went running off to the...
You have a problem with them, so go deal with them. I mean, it's a very peculiar situation where, and moreover, and I really wasn't like your comment on this, as far as I can tell, I understand that in general your interests don't align with the ILWU, but as to the issue you're raising here, they directly align with the ILWU, and the issue was raised and the issue was decided. Is that right?
It is right, but for whatever reason, we did not think that the ILWU position was argued as clearly.
But that it doesn't, your reasons don't particularly override the question of whether you're going to be fairly treated in. Get your issue before the board, and you did, and you will, whether you're there or not.
But we have successfully intervened over the decades in terms of these kinds of disputes.
In many instances, I can fully understand it. But as to this question, which is a pure legal question, a narrow legal question, a straightforward legal question, and it has been raised by the ILWU, and the ILWU would be crazy not to continue raising it, I don't understand why you have any great interest, or we have any great interest in letting you come here to get a preview of the decision.
We do, Your Honor, because we are administering a collective bargaining agreement for 70-some employers. The docs can be a situation where labor disputes can arise and affect the economy in a very dramatic way. I think the court could probably take judicial notice of the fact that all is not wonderfully well all the time between PMA and the ILWU.
But when the question is whether or not you have completely, is there any reason in the world why as to this issue your interests are not 100% aligned?
There is
hard time with us.
No. Well, there is a coincidental interest in seeing that this collective bargaining agreement is enforced, but that's as far as it goes. There are
issue bounds.
We don't think so, because certainly the ILWU would not have had standing to bring this LEADM case. Certainly they would not. We have that rare case where the board three times told us we may not be heard in this matter.
I don't understand why the ILWU wouldn't have the standing because they're already in the case.
Right. They're already in a case that has to go through.
You as an outsider who aren't in the case because you're not really directly involved are coming here to do something that's already been done anyway.
When you say, Your Honor, that we're not directly involved, we are directly involved. We participate in 10-Ks all the time. The board...
Extremely likely, given all that's happened since, that the board's going to let you in any further proceedings so as not to hear from us again.
I'm sorry, I missed the...
Isn't it very likely that the board is going to let you in any later proceedings?
Is going to...
Let you participate.
I have absolutely no idea. Certainly an administrative law judge could not, because the board has thrice said that the law of this case is that.
It's a different case.
Yeah. Your Honor, we would have liked the board to have understood the error of its ways, but it hasn't.
But it's a different
case. And it still doesn't. It has counsel here arguing today that what they did was fine absent the Noel Canning issue.
Can I ask just a clarifying question? You tried to intervene in the 10K proceeding, right?
Correct.
And were turned down?
Correct.
Okay. Did you try to intervene in the unfair labor practice proceeding?
No, Your Honor, but we tried twice more to intervene in the 10K matter.
I understand that. So,
okay.
Do you believe that ILWU can appeal under 10F from the unfair labor practice proceeding?
I see no reason why they could not.
Okay.
And those matters are before, well, on the secondary boycott cases, those matters are before the D.C. Circuit. Not on the 84D, which has been severed as a result of Judge Mossman's vacation of the board 10K.
I'm sorry, what's before the D.C. Circuit?
The D.C. Circuit has two cases before it on review involving conclusion findings of fact and conclusions of law by the board that the ILWU violated the secondary boycott provision, Section 84B of the Act. Those are pending.
They have nothing to do with this.
Your Honor, I submit that as well, but I think part of the difficulty is some of the issues from those cases. You ask why our interests are somewhat different and why our arguments are potentially somewhat different. They are. Those cases have gotten, in my view, bollocksed up on a right of control kind of issue instead of in a straightforward manner just arguing the plain statutory violation that the NLRB has done. With all due respect to the ILWU, I think the situation has been somewhat confused by their arguments, whereas our arguments have been
Were these cases mentioned anywhere in the briefs? Because I don't remember.
Oh, yes. And, in fact, the two of your honors were on the appellate 10L case a number of years ago.
I don't think there was anything in the D.C. Circuit.
That may have been a more recent development.
Right.
They haven't been briefed or argued yet.
Okay, so can I... Still unsure now about the status of your ability to get the issues that you're currently aligned on with ILWU. Can you get the issues separate or apart from the D.C. Circuit issue? Can you get the issues you want to raise adjudicated, addressed through the 10F?
We believe that the effective answer to that is no, Your Honor. And that is because there is no 10K as we speak. There is no 8B4D jurisdictional dispute case. If one arises, we could then seek to intervene there.
Yeah.
The administrative law judge would surely say that his bosses, the board, have decided that for purposes of this case, we have no right to intervene.
But that could still then go up through the board. Assumption that assumes there's no difference between a 10K and an 8B4D when we know that they're completely different and that the 10K is not res judicata in general. So why should it be res judicata on this?
It certainly is not res judicata, but the board laws, the effect that jurisdictional facts cannot be relitigated in a Section 8B4D complaint. And in any event, as I said, the judge would be hamstrung as a practical matter because he can't overrule the board. But then, once a board decision issues...
Just a minute. Yeah. You haven't asked, right? You haven't asked.
Not the fourth time.
Right.
As Judge Mossman said,
there was no ALJ in the 10K because there are no ALJs in 10Ks, right?
Of course.
All right. So... You haven't asked this guy. Does he exist yet? There's no pending proceeding, right?
There's not.
There will be.
Right.
So you could go when there is a pending proceeding, and you could ask. And if you don't get in, then you can come back and see us, right?
As Judge Mossman said, Your Honor, that is not a real alternative. We're supposed to, under LEADM, have a direct method of review within our control. We don't know what's going to happen with the 10K at this point. Is the board some 4 years into this now going to reschedule an 8B4D complaint?
Well, if they don't, then you certainly don't have a problem.
Pardon?
If they don't, then you have no problem.
Oh, yes, we do, Your Honor. and this is one of the reasons why it's so important to understand how PMA is impacted by this. Once the board issued a 10-K decision, PMA could not take any action to seek to enforce its collective bargaining agreement. The law is clear under Carey versus Westinghouse. The Supreme Court has said, once the board comes in, they have supremacy here. They take over, and any contract rights have to stop. And our contract rights have indeed...
What would happen?
Stopped. I'm sorry?
You did take steps. What would happen?
A Judge Simon, who has that case before him, has stated indefinitely. We have not been able to get our contract enforced for nearly a four-year period of time because of the issuance of this 10-K that is viewed as just a peripheral, non-race judicata type of matter. There are real-world consequences to the issuance of the 10-K. Let me address for a moment the Noel Canning, which I think takes us inevitably down a rabbit hole that doesn't seem to make practical sense. The board never had jurisdiction in this case to say, oh, but we're okay because the board members themselves were unauthorized. So let's just tear everything up and let's go back to square one after a four-year period of time and give the board an opportunity to correct the error of its ways and to get the right kinds of board members to make determinations in the case. That is not practical. It's not a meaningful exercise. We need the right to continue with the administration of our collective bargaining agreement with the adversary on the other side, the ILWU, that while we may have some coincidence of interests here, we are at odds with them on contract interpretation issues all the time and bargaining issues all the time. Our interest is not peripheral to this matter. It is real and dramatic, and as we try to keep peace on the docks up and down the coast, it is a true struggle. Multi-employer bargaining is a very difficult animal. It's very important to the economy to have it, as the Supreme Court has noted in the Brown v. NFL case. It is an important principle, and we are seeking to enforce that collective bargaining agreement. Let the ILWU know that when we make a bargain, a bargain is a bargain.
The case that you said that's before Judge Mossman, the contract case, who's the case between?
Who is the case?
I say, are you suing the ILWU or you're suing the employer? Or both?
We are suing ITSE, the contractor in this case, the member who did not proceed along the lines that it was obligated to do, to get enforcement of the arbitration award. And indeed, then, we have been countersued on a raft of claims as well by them, including antitrust, which Judge Mossman has pitched in large part. But nonetheless, he has kept alive a portion of the case, saying that PMA violated its duty of fair representation to ITSE in the way it handled this matter. This non-jurisdictional dispute has spurned a ton of litigation, and it is very complex.
Representation among employers.
A novel concept, I would agree, Your Honor. Absolutely. Absolutely. So we think that the only thing that makes practical sense in this matter is to affirm Judge Mossman's decision. And he said, by the way, when he took the bench that day, that he was inclined to dismiss the case. But after hearing the interests and what the NLRB had done and the fact that we did not have a meaningful opportunity to go forward on it, it was just a hypothetical opportunity.
This is the problem. It isn't hypothetical because the unfair labor practice has not occurred. And you say you'll lose if you intervene, but how do we know that unless you do it? mean, so it's very unhypothetical. It's completely unhypothetical.
So how can the board be rewarded for missing something three times and then having the matter up here on appeal? 4 years have now gone. We have to go back to square one in order to get a complaint and an administrative law judge proceeding where, again, we believe that any good administrative law judge would say, I have no discretion in this matter, even though I think it's wrong. But then appeal that to the board, then the board issues a decision, then that case goes up, and in that case, if we've had a right to, if we have in fact intervened successfully, then we can say we're a party. If we haven't had a right to intervene, we say we're a person.
My response is that if you hadn't brought this proceeding, the 10K wouldn't have been vacated, and the 8B4D proceedings wouldn't have been stayed, and you would be 4 years further down the road.
Absolutely, but that would have required us to sacrifice a situation where we believe we fit squarely within the confines of Lead and Be Kind. In fact, we think the union in Lead and Be Kind was better situated to get review than we are in this case.
Okay, your time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Mr. Cohn. Yes, sir.
Your Honor, 10F review is still available to PMA. The board, and the reason is because of the board is holding in abeyance a final decision on certain portions of the ALJ's rulings that are dependent on the validity of the 10K decision. Also, the board has also suspended
now
briefing.
Now it's the 8B4G hearings have already been held.
The 8B4D hearings have already been held, but the board is withholding issuance of a decision on the 8B4D pending.
No, he couldn't go and intervene now before the ALJ.
Well, he would be, a motion to intervene would be filed with the board, and because briefing has been suspended, PMA could conceivably move to intervene and participate in the briefing and get its arguments regarding the validity of the 10K decision before the board.
Mr. Cohn also said that the jurisdictional issue is not up for review. Is that correct? In other words, although in general the 10K proceedings are not res judicata in the 8B4G, he seemed to be suggesting that the question of board's jurisdiction would be, i.e., that the board would not now revisit the question of its jurisdiction.
Well, I'm talking about the current, the board decision that is pending right now. The board has withheld a decision. The ALJ relied on a 10K decision to basically say that they are bound by that. So now the matter is before the board. So PMA wants to get its arguments regarding the validity of the 10K decision before the board. It has an opportunity, and the board has indicated or has advised PMA that it would not oppose any motion to intervene.
The board, you don't mean the board, you mean the general counsel.
The general counsel, correct.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The case of PMA versus NLRB is submitted, and we will go to the last case of the